Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Whitney Museum. My name is Sasha Wurzel. I'm the Director of Access and Community Programs here. It's my great pleasure and honor to welcome you to Barbara Hammer, The Art of Dying, or Palliative Art Making in the Age of Anxiety. In Barbara's long and deeply prolific career, she's tackled all kinds of topics and has never shied away from the taboo, the controversial. We were just talking about this earlier. And so she's explored sex, sexuality, the body, illness, and so why not explore the experience of death and dying? And that's what she's going to be talking about tonight. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you to Izzy and Max and the whole team for supporting on this. Thank you, Flory. Thank you to our video crew. And please stay after. We're going to have a small reception to raise a glass to Barbara. And thank you especially to Barbara for your life and work, which has deeply impacted me and definitely made this place a better world. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, dear friends, for being here tonight. It does my heart good. And you don't know this museum. This is a museum that 3 weeks ago I called and I said, Sasha, you know, there's a few people on Facebook who'd like to see this performance that I've been doing. Would you be able to give me a date? There was October 10th, you know? I only had time to rewrite my script, which is just what I needed, because this is the fourth iteration. First, it was performed spontaneously at Temple University in Philadelphia when I received an award. I didn't know that I would be well enough to go, and I was, so hence the lecture. Then it was performed at Tyler School of Art, also in Philadelphia. And then a few weeks ago, it was at Yale. So I'm very happy to consider this the final iteration here at the Whitney. And thanks to Sasha and the whole education department of this lovely museum, Isabel Dow and Max Chester in particular. So here we go. The Art of Dying, Palliative Art Making in an Age that we're living in, the age of anxiety. There is a general fear of talking about death in the Western world. It is as if by not mentioning and discussing it, it would go away. We do ourselves a disservice to not engage in ruminations of this most powerful life force. For aren't we alive until our last breath? And isn't this a rite of passage we wish to address in our art, in our seminars, and in our museum exhibitions? By hesitating to face the last phase of life, we give a message to hush up and avoid. And platitudes then come out like, you'll get better. You're tough, you'll beat it. You know, you look good today. Instead of discussing terminal disease. We in the art world, all of us, artists, curators, administrators, art lovers alike, are avoiding one of the most potent subjects we can address. I'm happy to see that there is a recent change in our few organizations that are planning seminars on health, illness, death, and dying right now. And artists are coming out with transparency, finally, as they break the fear of coming out as being ill. And you can think of what the ramifications of that are for an artist. Guess what? The art of dying is the same as the art of living. Whew, we got that over with. We can all relax now, right? The pain of living in these times, as we all know, of inhumanity, requiring resistance, marching, demonstrating, can be relieved by making art. Relief from pain through palliative art making can save us discomfort from living with this injustice and violence that we see every day. But it does not treat the basis for the pain. We can change the underlying cause of pain, disrespect, racism, sexism, classism, ageism, physicalism, on and on, with brave, strong art. We know the pleasure that comes from the creative process, whether it's defiance of restrictive social mores or deliverance through ecstatic expression. Our art can make a difference. I hope that what is important to you stands out most clearly, as it has for me, when life is measured in months instead of years. I hope you will make your work from the place of needing to create without paying heed to the sugar-coated traps of success promised by the art world. I hope you will not use the guise of name-dropping or the focus on getting to know those in power to distract from your personal creativity. The art of living, the art of making. Here are the precepts and ways of working that I have found most helpful. These are the principles and considerations that have guided me through 50 years of practice. I hope they can be useful to you. So, be open to your intuition, and pleasure yourself in the joy of making. There is no way to make plans, prepare, control. Everything is contingent. There's no solidity to count on except what you claim. Everything has a qualifier. When you have an idea, follow it with gusto and pleasure, having as much fun as possible all the way. So there I was in graduate school, San Francisco State, 1972, and I gathered a group of people who would like to go, they were all women, to the country with me for a weekend to witches' land, self-proclaimed witches' land. Up in Napa County, it was fall. The leaves were falling. The foliage was beautiful. And I asked the women to perform, or else I directed self-direction, performance. Would you like go out and dance or hug this tree? Why not kiss a tree? Oh, yes, I know, I was from Berkeley. Okay. We had a ball. All weekend, we performed, we shot. And at that time, you know, I'd made a three-minute film before that. And so I thought, I've got 100 minutes now. No, I only had 60 minutes. I have an hour, so that's enough to make a feature, right? So I thought, okay, the weekend's over. Let's all go back home. We had a good time. So we went back, and I went into the editing room at San Francisco State and locked myself in to spend the night cutting. And let me tell you, the footage was there, but I was so bored. I fell asleep. So I cut 60 minutes. I don't know, I keep saying 100. 60 minutes into 2 minutes. Woo! I cut for the action, but there was so much beautiful footage that I thought, I've got to show that. So I started layering it so that my movie scope was holding 4 pieces of film going through at one time. And of course, you couldn't see it very smoothly, but I could get an idea of what I would get. And it went to the lab then, sight unseen. I had great pleasure in making didactics. 1974, 4 minutes, I give it to you now.
You're doing great.
Thank you. Well, sometimes there isn't spontaneity, there's intention. The reason is didactics was misunderstood back in the early 70s. It was seen sometimes by some people as pornographic. And I wanted to set the record straight. This was not my intention, was to make a film to arouse, although if you were, that was fine, but it was not my intention. So I had no idea of what to do at first, and then I realized that I needed to make work that would be clear, that this, you would understand that this work was made from the sense of touch, that my experience of the world, for instance, seeing this floor, the smoothness on it, the scratches on it, I actually am feeling it in my body while I'm looking at it. Jung identified it as one of four major kinds of intelligence. It's called sensation, not sensation, you know, like a rock show, although we could have that today too, but sensation that you feel in your body. And that's the way I primarily experience the world. There's intuition as well, there's intelligence, and there's joy of feeling, but an emotion, emotional intelligence. So I began to study the sense of touch, and I was shocked to find that there was only one book in the library by Ashley Montague on touching. And in reading that, I found out that I wasn't too surprised that the clitoris makes up most of the area in our brain of our sense of touch, along with the primary fingers and the penis and other areas of the body, but it makes up a huge area that I don't think we're conscious of and that we spend enough time thinking about. And I wanted my cinema to bring this sense of who I am, the sensational, into your bodies as you watch the screen. So I made a film called Sync Touch, Synchronous Touch, where I looked at four different ways of experiencing this idea. A synchronous sound, of course, but of course not on the lips, but around the lips and on the face. A child playing, because aren't we first of all very tactile as children before we learn to not touch? And several other ways. A French lesson becomes extremely tactile. And this became the film Sync Touch. And I want you to become aware of your physical body through watching this film. Of course, we just have four clips and they're short, so don't be down on yourself if you don't have the experience. I'll invite you back another time. Let's roll Sync Touch.
Environment, even in sleep. The greatest sense in our body is our sense of touch. It is probably the chief sense in the processes of sleeping and waking. It gives us our knowledge of depth, thickness, and form. Of depth, thickness, and form. We feel, we love and hate through the touch corpuscles of our skin.
La langue féministe.
La langue féministe.
est complète et complète. Elle réunit la tête au corps.
La tête au corps.
L'intellect et la raison.
Et la raison
aux sensations physiques.
Aux sensations
physique et aux émotions.
Et aux émotions.
Aux émotions. Nous sommes dans une culture
où le corps
et l'expression sensuelle sont réprimés.
Sometimes there's pain in creating, and it's not something to avoid. I know that a few of my most successful films have come when I've either cried at the editing bench or I found myself menstruating outside of my period time. And I knew I had something powerful when I had this emotional body reaction to what I was making. David Wonovovich made fragile, deeply dark installations of rage and dying, as seen recently during the retrospective here at the Whitney and at the gallery PPOW. Can we assume that he found some relief by making these extraordinary tracks ignored by our AIDS-blind society and complicit government? I think I can say that he did find energy and passion to make this work that drew directly from his pain of living with AIDS. And aren't all artists dealing with mortality with every brushstroke, every frame of film? Then we can say, aren't all people living with mortality, no matter what their profession or life choice? The question becomes one of awareness. Is the artist perhaps unconsciously at first trying to fight inevitable death by stacking up the artworks, hiding the foregone erasure of the body, ensuring a mark on cultural history, or assuaging daily anxiety from the consciousness that life will end? Working with the extraordinary collection of Dr. James Sibley Watson's moving x-rays of the human body, I was profoundly moved by the beauty of the interior organs, the skeleton structure, and the bodily fluids. Knowing that these images were gathered by a dangerous method, the people were being exposed to x-rays while they were being filmed, I felt pain for those whose lives may have been shortened at the same time that I felt beauty for the interior of the body. Sanctus is 19 minutes, and we'll watch a few clips of this 1990 16mm film now.
Thank you.
It was so fortuitous when I found in the up at the Eastman house that last shot. It hadn't been used, in, as far as I know, in any of Sibley Watson's films. And so it was to me like he was kissing me and saying, yes, you should rework my footage when I saw that the end there. Speaking of the end, everyone has a right to die when she wishes. Thank you. We don't have the right to choose our birth, but why don't we have the right to choose our death and determine the time of it, should we wish to? This especially applies to people like me with terminal cancer. I have lived a good long life. I just know that you know that. But now I have reached a period of living with increased diminished capabilities due to a cancer that can't be cured and for which I have had every treatment possible. I am in palliative care and preparing for the end. I feel fortunate that I have the awareness of this approaching death, allowing me to make plans, say goodbyes, and settle affairs. But I'm angry, not about my impending death, although there have been times when I have been angry about that, of course, but that the government has determined that I must linger through probable unconsciousness, pain, or in a deep drugged state, preventing me from being aware. I prefer a conscious death. A death I can be proud of, a dignified death, a death where I have a chance to clearly say goodbye to friends and family, a death where I'm able to save my spouse the agony of watching me suffer or lie in a coma for days. I tell you now that this is my life and should be my death. I should be able to ask a physician to assist me in my death. It is I who should determine my ultimate demise, not a government, distant and remote, to whom I owe no allegiance. I should have the right to die with a physician's help. As I stood by years ago watching my father die, in prison by a life-preserving intubation tube from which he could not speak and from which he would never return without, I was luckily asked by an empathetic nurse if she could increase the morphine. This was a rare opportunity and one most of us facing death in this society will not have. I ask all of you to take this into consideration and to support the Right to Die with Dignity movement and the passage of the New York legislation of the Death and Dignity Act. These are some clips from Vital Signs that I made in 2009, a 9-minute film, and the clips, you know, are condensed to a few minutes. Vital Signs.
Say, Something fell off the ventilator, and it's starting to make those sounds. Five, 52.
Like this for days.
Cancer can break the illusion of life without end. And one of the precepts that I've followed in my practice has been to break the pattern of work, not to repeat myself as my films have gone on or my painting or installations, but always to challenge myself and try to make something new for me. It's a truism that you're supposed to live every day as if it's your last. How do any of us know what our last day is like? And there's no way to do that. And you don't even know what it will look like. And perhaps you wouldn't want to be living that day every day if you did. Isn't that a silly truism? What we can do is create from a sense of discovery every day that we are given to live. Once you start working in a certain mode, it'd be easy to follow those patterns all your creative life, you know. I say move beyond that. I say take a piece of film and tear it, or bury it in the hot summer sun. Let it, fade and mulch, and then bring it up in the winter and wash it off and see what you have. What a surprise, what a discovery, what pleasure that can give you to see something new that you've never seen before. Try toner or bleach. Look at the fragility of film as much as our heartbeat. This is a mode from which to make radical life-affirming art. So I'd never seen a film on what it was like to go through chemotherapy. And by now I've had 100 chemo treatments, Florey counted them. But back in 2006, when the cancer was discovered, I had endometrioid chemotherapy. It went directly into your stomach. And then I used to do yoga on the bed in the hospital to try to move the chemical around because, you know, I wanted to do the best I could to achieve success with the treatment. Well, you know, I got almost 13 years. That's not bad. but I had never seen a film on what chemotherapy is like and what it does to the body. And so I made this film called A Horse Is Not a Metaphor. It's 30 minutes, 2009. And again, we'll just look at a few clips.
Ah, 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 ah As we've discussed and the tests have confirmed, you have ovarian cancer, stage 3.
It's just ironic that the two horses that I would start out with also were ill with tumors.
I think it's really important when you're in the studio to be honest with yourself. Honesty. People speak of cancer using truisms and what they've heard others say. You can't beat it, you're strong. I'm here to tell you that this disease has its own timed progression, and personal strength may be of some deterrence, but not much. And who beats cancer? More egregious comments align cancer with war. You see it in the mistaken analogies in obituaries every day. They say, she fought a good battle, you know, or cancer, she outlasted the war for a long time. Cancer is not a battle, it's not a war, and I am not fighting. I am living with cancer and have been living with cancer, and am grateful to have done this by living fully. There was a particular year of undergoing chemotherapy that was pretty difficult and had a lot of side effects. And I undertook what I considered to be my last visual project, a film and an installation called Evidentiary Bodies. Being sick leaves you without much disguise. And in a way, that's really helpful in the studio when you're being honest. And I had my assistant, Angel Favorite, come over every day and film, well, not every day, one day a week is what I could manage. And we would perform sort of what I intuitively wanted to show what my illness felt like to whoever wanted to see it eventually. And we could usually just do one idea at a time, and then the rest of the week, as I was resting and regaining strength, I would ruminate on what I'd want to do the following week. So this went on for quite a good time, and I had a lot of footage at the end, which became a real labor to edit because I never looked back at it as I was moving through the shooting. Well, the accumulation edit finally ended in an HD 3-channel film that premiered at the Berlin Film Festival last February. But the projection didn't hold the intimacy for me that I wanted, and you'll see it today like it was shown in Berlin. But I've been honored with a promise to have it during an exhibition of all my work that has dealt with mortality and aging and illness at the Wexner Center for the Arts next summer. So there it'll be seen as 3 screens. And you will be on a small bench with just a few other people in an intimate setting. And you can stay as long as you want to watch the film that'll be on a loop and to enter into that dark, intimate space. You pass through X-ray screens of the chest, 3 or 4 of them, on which are projected CAT scans of my body. And luckily, these CAT scans came in all kinds of beautiful colors. I think it was for UCLA. I was trying to determine why are these, I had like 13 choices from the CD they gave me. You know, why these colors? I thought, well, it must be a code for that particular school. And they were making these so they could travel with the patient. So this is the way I want it to be shown, my favorite way, but then not many people will get to see it. So I wanted to give you the opportunity tonight and people in the future to see this film and the person, the wonderful friend of mine, the cellist and architect and artist, Norman Scott Johnson is here, who did the soundtrack with his beautiful cello on the film. So this is a 9-minute film, it's the whole film, Evidentiary Bodies. Thank you. you. Thank you. Like a conscious death, there's also the conscious archive. Be aware that someone you never met will one day look at your projects, your posters, your objects, not having any idea where they came from or what they mean. Take the time now to catalog. No. I never knew that was funny. I'm really glad it's funny. Note the dates and times and places, because this will give that person some context in the years to come. Consciously saving, collecting, storing away needn't be fancy or difficult, just consistent. I'm shy to say that I didn't follow archival practices for storage, but I just used a plain old cardboard box and put the things in it until later when I had to organize. But at least it was saved, even if roughly. And the time spent at that then didn't impede my creative activity. Being conscious, too, of the importance of the choices made of what to save and what to discard. For example, I had a digital printing project. All the notes of the sizes, the papers I used, and the printer I used were saved. The quickly printed Xerox references that showed all the different pieces I could do in the week I had at this residency were saved. The emails with the assistant about our discussion, what we could do, the limitations and processes were saved. The images themselves are on piles of CDs begging for migration to digital files, but they're saved. If I had not taken the time to save my projects, I would not be able to be the proud artist today who has her paper archive in the Beinecke Rare Book and Manuscript Library at Yale. I just got to visit a few weeks ago and actually see the lovely room that you get to look at the boxes in, with a Noguchi courtyard and sculpture, white marble, out the window. It's a gorgeous architectural phenomenon, and I am so happy to have the papers there. The artwork, the databases of my drawings, my paintings, my collages, photographs, and installations and films for my galleries company here in New York and KOW in Berlin is almost finished. In one of the Yale boxes was a stuffed duffel bag of outfits. I used to wear outfits at film shows. I mean, you know, everything's an outfit, right? So I got a little bit depressed during this archiving process that did go on for a couple of years because I wasn't being creative, just looking at old work, you know. And I didn't know what was wrong, and then I figured out I wasn't being creative. So it was kind of hard to let all those 50 boxes or more go out the door. And so when this duffel bag was going to go, I thought, wait a minute. And I held it back and had Flory come over for art direction and Lou Bank come to film me, and I put on 12 of my favorite outfits with my precious films, cameras and light meters and all the paraphernalia that goes with filmmaking. And I was able to have a lot of fun wearing the Super Dyke t-shirt one more time and a cultural workers jumpsuit and strike crazy poses, resulting in 12 digital images, and for you, a 45-second GIF. Let it roll. 2017. One thing I found out was by having a disease, people are more important than my work. Really, this was mind-blowing to me. And maybe to Andy Warhol, whose show's coming up here, because I saw the catalog of his work and how incessant. He was 7 days a week. I was only five. So, but I found that, you know, it's really not only my family and my friends, it's also the people I meet every day. It's the cashiers, the people running the checking counter, the check-ins, the strangers on the street, and of course, your most significant others. And to be able to be grateful publicly and to tell you is really important to me, that I have dedicated friends at the Academy of Motion Pictures of Arts and Sciences in Hollywood who are restoring and preserving and conserving all of my 16 millimeter film. That is such an honor. And to the more than helpful folks right here, not a few blocks away, at Electronic Arts Intermix, Lori Zippe, Rebecca Clayman, Carl McCool, I know them so well, why am I reading them? And John Derringer, they're like there every day on the phone with me if I need something. I am also fortunate that my niece, Lane Bretscheider, has taken over my legacy work with the DVD distribution. But most important, I couldn't be here today without the loving support and care of my partner, my spouse, for 30 years. 30 years! Oh, who would have known? Flory Burke, who is... Come here. She has guided me, loved me, and now as caregiving, and that's not a small role, and art legacy management to a long list of supportive roles. Thank you, Flory. I am filled with gratitude every day. Gratitude that I've been able to create for 50 years. Gratitude for the friends, colleagues, and those of you, all of you that are here, I know so many of you, who've supported my work, and you have, throughout this long time of art making. I'm happy to have introduced students and friends to the wild world of experimental film. God bless you. I am grateful that I can give back by supporting two annual grants, the Queer Filmmaking Award for a student at San Francisco State University and the Barbara Hammer Lesbian Experimental Filmmaking Grant through Queer Art. And before we enter the final stage of this event, I want to remind you to vote. Now, usually a Q&A follows a lecture, but instead tonight we're going to have an A and Q. Yes! So that means you answer and I query. Yes. And so, I've noticed your bright face throughout my lecture. I'd like you to tell me what film image is staying with you and what your feelings are about it.
The image of being pulled out of your control and kind of on the ground, felt like there was some struggle in it and some inevitability in it, that it was some combination of something happening to you and something that you were doing.
Thank you for seeing the complexity in that image. Now, I wonder what you're thinking about the experience of death and what I've been saying about it. What are you thinking about your death?
Whoa! Now, I'm going to a friend here. I'm not trying to embarrass somebody I don't know. Just somebody who's really a good friend.
Oh, Barbara.
Make up your own question, then.
No. I mean, it's interesting. Yeah, mortality's actually been a big topic this year. Because I did a bunch of work with David, thinking about David. And I feel like I think I've also made certain choices to kind of retract. There's something about aging and wanting to kind of withhold and hold on to my personal resources. And so I don't know if death is my primary thought, but I feel held by certain kind of reflections and elders. I think I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you. And Angel Favorite is here, who did the shooting for Evidentiary Bodies. Angel, how did it look to you tonight?
It was very beautiful. I enjoy seeing it every time. Thank you.
I let her off the hook. Now going into the hinterland here. Oh, Susie Duvall, Creative Capital. Wonderful organization where the artists are able to give back. We don't just take the money and run. We give back. I tried to give you today, and I think when I was interviewed by Creative Capital recently, hi, Alex. So I had the idea then that I should give a lecture on dying. And actually, that was quite a while ago, a year or two. And this is actually the result of it. So how are you going to use this kind of information and thought process that I've shared with your wonderful organization?
Thanks, Barbara. Well, I've been sitting here and really thinking what a gift this is to so many, what a gift this really is for so many. Because I think you're right, we have such a hard time dealing with inevitable. I mean, it is one thing that we know for certain, that we're all gonna get there. And I'm inspired by the grace and intelligence and emotional being that you've taken on, that you've taken this on and saying, I'm gonna own this. And I think we have been talking, thanks to you, about what we should be doing and helping. And I think initially we really thought about some of the practical aspects that we want artists to think around their legacy. But it is really beyond that. It is actually the whole being when we think about coming to terms with that and what does that mean and the individual approach that anybody would like to take to it. So thank you for helping us think that through, and I hope that some part of that we can actually use that within whatever we share with. And I have to say that you have been one of our most generous of artists in paying back and paying forward what you have learned and the way that you're setting up your grant. So this as well, we hope will continue to pay forward to others. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And I want to say hello to all the people that are watching online. And hello, Bloomington, Indiana, and Carmel Curtis and her gang. Hello, Brussels and London, and friends of mine there. I'm very happy that you're able to join us today. And I just have a few more people I want to search out. And this is a long time friend. We have been through it together, haven't we?
Yes, we have.
This is my friend Jack Waters, who's going to tell us whatever he wants to. He got a free ride home.
Well, Barbara, I have to say, and I've said this to you before, that it's no coincidence that your last name is Hammer. And I don't think I'm the only one who refers to you as simply the Hammer.
What could be better? Shelley Silver right in the front row, watching me with the saddest of face. Was this a difficult lecture to sit through? Because I'm on the other end. I don't really know.
Quite honestly, yes. Yes. It is an extraordinary gift, because I think you're right that we don't think about these things. We push it out of our brain. My father died this year, and I think what I took from that was this feeling of carrying him with me, also for better and for worse, but also this feeling of letting go. And I think that I refuse to let go of you, but I want to let go of me when the time comes.
To let go of you?
Yes, to let go of me, to let go, yeah. Uh-huh. So, yeah.
It's beautiful. Thank you so much, Flory. Oh, no, she says. Does someone have the right to say, oh, no, to me? I won't hear of it.
30 years.
30 years. My name is Hammer. Okay, into the light, babe. Into the light. Oh, we got the light.
In the light. What? Are you going to? You have to ask me a question, I think.
People see me as a performer tonight, but you know me as a person who sometimes performs at home, but what would you say is the most difficult thing about me? Whoa! This is for the record, and the most wonderful.
You're a Taurus, and you're really stubborn and bullheaded. The wonderful part is, this was extraordinary. And yes, it was very hard. And I so admire you and your strength and your willingness to be open to all these wonderful people and to share what's very, very personal, because it needs to be shared.
I love you with all my heart. And I love all of you. And please join us in the foyer for a glass of Prosecco. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you and you and you. Yes. Let's go enjoy ourselves with some